Remove. Greg, can you hit the top left?
I hate waiting, but if it means being able to be with you, I'll wait as long as forever to be with you.
Aww.
Hey, Ben, would you read this right here?
Every minute feels like an hour. Every hour feels like a day. Every day feels like forever. But I will wait forever and engage with you.
That's sweet. Tupi, the last one.
Our willingness to wait reveals the value we place on what we're waiting for.
A lot of good things to say about waiting.
Yeah.
And we'll return to that one in a little bit here. We got two escapes. One was a paperwork issue. It was supposed to ship out via UPS, and that was not on the paperwork. UPS picks up at 2 p.m. And
Jimmy, get in, guys. Make room. Thank you. Just no back row in this company.
Sorry, sir. Yeah, so wrong notation on the paperwork. UPS ships at 2 p.m., and it got over there later than 2 p.m. We had to ship it. There was some costs associated with shipping.
We're working on a system.
Sweet, good.
And
then a crate. Crates were built slightly too small. I had to send the pedestals on pallets beforehand and then send a second shipment the following day. So hopefully we've hansaid on that one. And moving on. Where are we at, guys? Anybody not know where they're at? Anybody not working at anything that is yellow line for today? Or
is it cool? Is that correct? Need help?
I just got the codes. So I need to see 12, please.
So you need another body in the codes?
Is it cut? The film needs to be cut.
Wait, you're waiting.
No, I just got the codes.
Okay.
So I want to get a flow and figure out.
Okay. These are going out tomorrow, these white glass here. Anything else? Everybody knows what they're supposed to be doing?
Yeah, cool.
Okay. We created this cool little tool here. We go around and we exit if somebody's in here today. Then we put in here how many labor hours we have past due for capacity, and then or for workload, and then how much we have due out the next 5 days. And we're averaging that out so that within every 5 day cycle, we're trying to create some Heijunka or leveling the load within 5 day cycles. And that gives us our workload and our capacity. And of course, if our workload is ever above our capacity, it means that we're in the red. And so then what we can do is, what this tells us over here is how long a day all the full-timers would need to work, so it'd be 8.5 hours today, and then when people need to stay till, so that's 4 p.m. basically. So this is a tool that's gonna bring a little more objectivity into where we're at right now, and then we'll eventually get smarter because we're gonna realize, well, actually, we need to add 10% more into that and stay a little later in anticipation of rushes or whatever may come in the next 4 days. But this is kind of a next step so that we're working not in a vacuum, but in the real world with real numbers.
So this will replace the John Don.
Yeah, this is the next step up from the John Don. quick review here of prioritizing orders on the floor. If there's any lack of clarity on this, this will get printed out and pasted up. But I just wanted to put this in front of everybody again.
Where do you expect to paste it?
We'll put it here.
Okay.
I don't know where else it can go.
Certainly in here on this wall.
I think the beginning of each value stream should have that.
Okay.
So the CNC, the main saw.
Anywhere
where you're going to start adding value to a product, okay. Just start them in order, and then detailing doesn't need to worry about which one's yellow because it should be the first one to get to them.
Sure. No overprocessing.
Where the question lies.
Can you raise your hands if you can name the 8 wastes. Almost everybody. It's pretty good.
It's just 7 now because W is no longer a waste.
Oh, that's true. We love waiting.
We love
which is kind of funny. Toyota defines waiting as workers merely serving to watch an automated machine, which only really exists in CNC, and we dealt with that long ago, or having to stand around waiting for the next processing step, tool, supply, part, waiting in acrylics for cut parts, or just plain having no work because of stockouts, lot processing delays, equipment downtime, and capacity bottlenecks like at the CNC. So just kind of give us a baseline of definition around what waiting is. And we want to talk really quickly about what waiting looks like, what it feels like, and if anybody has any stories about waiting here at Xylem.
Anybody waiting for test results right now? How about someone they know and love that's waiting on results for some medical testing?
I was waiting.
How does that feel?
No good.
No good.
No. Anxious. Yeah.
It's even worse when you deal with something, but you don't know what to have.
Right.
The unknown.
Yeah.
Better to at least know something, right?
Yeah.
So why does Corda call it one of the eight ways?
It could be productive.
Okay.
And I ordered parts for my car, and it came from Kansas. Almost the car I'd afforded it took 5 days.
Okay.
I don't think I was mad after the third day.
Yeah.
Well, the horse was tired.
Yep.
There's a. You're not adding value if you're waiting.
Yeah. What does waiting? So this is a bigger discussion. Seth brought it in Toyota. You can bring it back and forth for sure. But what? Who suffers from the most waiting exposure? Who's the most vulnerable? Our customer. Right. And in this environment, we're trying to get to a mindset of what about the customer concept. Yeah, the next person is the customer, right? So we're certainly dealing with our end customer. One piece. Hannah, what was your thought?
I was just going to say it's really easy to get stuck in this idea that there's nothing else that you can be doing when you're waiting on something, because then you just get stuck and you stop doing anything, and there's, like, that doesn't have to do with
it. Yeah. It is. You're not helpless. If you got one thing,
yeah. You
got to have a B thing. Like, if you're working on a couple of projects for improvements and you're waiting on a part to come in, or waiting for the person to tell you how to do that, or Kaizen, you can still do other simpler stuff. I had a discussion with a friend of mine who works in fairly far up the food chain in the Fort Collins government, and he had gone through an enormous amount of effort to put together this very big proposal that went right up to the main guy, and he and his team were waiting a month for the gov to get back to them, so to speak, right? I'm thinking, how did that feel? They put a lot of this, they were frustrated.
Turn the desk off.
Kill it. Anyhow, he just told this very well-told story of all of the people on his staff waiting and the anxiety and what happens when you're waiting about this. So we gave the proposal to that big shot. What do we think he's thinking, right? And what do?
Doubt.
When we're waiting, what are we thinking in our heads? Any thoughts?
They think they're better than us.
That? What else?
That they're incompetent. I mean,
you start to worry.
I feel disrespected sometimes when I'm waiting. You know that I'm here, you know that I need that thing, you know, give me my coffee, or whatever it is, you know, what's taking so long? You don't think that I'm in a hurry, my time's valuable, you get angry.
We make stories up in our heads, and we don't know what's actually gone. See, you know what's going on? One of the busiest guys around had one of thousands of emails that went across his desk, and it didn't lodge, and he didn't act on it, and the guy didn't say, hey, did you get my email? Like 2 days later, just want to make sure you got it, right? That could have short-circuited all that. Yeah, I got it. Really appreciate it, Joe. My staff's planning on looking at it next Friday. Breathe easy, right? Or the stories in everybody's head were way out of control by the time they heard back. Talk about a waste of time, a month before you could have just given it. So that just protracted that decision-making process horribly. Ben?
I know when I wait on something, I'm more critical of it when it arrives.
Sure.
I judge it a little bit more strongly.
It was well worth waiting for. Or it showed up and it sucks. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
I waited for this? Yeah. Our time is valuable. We may not realize it, but impatience is probably connected to our mortality on some level. That's what I would suspect.
And it turns on the critical eye, too, because if my dad was terrible at getting stuff delivered on time and I became a part of that problem, and when we showed up late, they had the critical eye on. And at that point, all the little things they never would have seen or cared about, they started seeing and caring about.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole project just continued to slide down the hill. Avoiding that precipice is ideal.
Yeah. There's an enormous amount of layers. There are enormous amount of layers from my experience. What's going on?
Just think how forgiving the customer is for arriving early. Exactly. Yes. And so part of that is we've always put so much pressure on the production here, and rightfully so, but we're realizing that if half of our customers have event time-sensitive orders and we don't get it on time, we might as well not even have made it in the first place. So the delivery is as important as the building, and that's why we're starting to really develop what we're calling the logistics team, who are really owning, removing the drama and all the ambiguity, so you guys have all the information you need on the floor to serve your customer, which really is the logistics team in part. That's the next person in the chain of command. So that's the customer for the floor.
You need to give them what they need when they need it so they can successfully deliver on what they have promised to deliver on, what they're in charge of. So anyway, it's an exciting kind of shift here, and I think it'll serve us well. That's going to go move up the food chain as it influences the conscientiousness of the floor. That's going to even move up into the sales office, and then we'll eventually have better tools to know and understand what we can and can send your way in terms of capacity, so that we're not expecting you guys to eat 100 watermelon in 5 minutes.
Challenge accepted.
Yeah. This is, we'll get to this later. This is around kind of creating sous chefs as a new column in the training matrix, and how a lot of the time that's wasted is on things that we could have done before production starts. So that, imagine coming in every Monday and everything everywhere is completely stocked, AP Pros, bifolds, quick sets, all the cardboard, all the foam, everything everywhere. All you gotta do is grab and go. So we have a hard week of production, mm-hmm. and every week and everything gets refreshed, and then you come back in and hit it hard again. So that's kind of something we wanna move toward. It's also low hanging fruit for new hires, because it's easier to execute on. Quality isn't as hard to control.
Thanks, Seth.
And shout out.
I wanna shout out whoever cleaned up my mess that I left last night. I'm really sorry, and I had to come in late this morning. So it was all cleaned up when I got here, so whoever cleaned that up, I would shout out.
You're welcome.
Tony, what do you got?
I got one for Sean.
Right.
He's doing great.
Thank you, Tony.
So he's positivity and try to teach what you've been learning. Good way.
You're here.
Good job, man.
Shout out Hannah Glebe. She was teaching someone stuff this morning. It was really neat to see that, the confidence about what you were doing and what you were teaching. There's nothing better than teaching to force yourself to learn.
Yeah.
So.
Shout out to 2P for MBS for implementing the new priority list already.
You got it?
No, yeah, it's great to have that structure. There.
Sweet.
I'd like to shout out Jeff for mind-blowing service. Just everything he's helped me with is exactly right.
Mike and Wendy for knowledge sharing.
Shout out to you, Seth, for continuous improvement on the Excel spreadsheet you made, making it visual for everybody on like just why you can execute the way you do, and that 5-day plan. That's pretty cool how you orchestrated that. And whoever else was a part of it, somebody else was.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Shout out whoever brought those cinnamon rolls.
That's FedEx.
Great.
That was FedEx.
Yeah.
FedEx.
Yeah, that's
all.
FedEx. $250,000 in business, you get free donuts.
There we go.
What a deal.
Thanks, Greg.
Well, actually, if he hears us talking about, he hears us throwing around the word UPS, he goes to Silver Grill, steps it up from the donuts. It's funny. Okay, that's it. We have more paper.